But I would like to begin by saying that I think all discussion about groundwater governance in India is an exercise in shadow boxing. Because the groundwater economy, it's a bubble economy. It's an economy that has been created and artificially supported by the OPA for subsidies. And this basically began in 1970s. And things have come to such a pass that all critical water management agencies, including the Central Groundwater Board or the irrigation departments, have been forced completely to the margins of the groundwater economy. In Gujarat, for example, which has a large irrigated area, the most important government player for the most important area of groundwater governance is the junior minister for power, called Sarah Patel. Actually, the irrigation minister has very little to do with the way the majority of Gujarati farmers do their irrigation business. In that sense, I think the Indian groundwater story is very different from the Chinese groundwater story. And I think that there are several ways of describing this. One is direct versus indirect. There is micro demand management versus micro demand management. And I think that what seems to be happening now in different states of India is an exercise of broad spectrum macro level management, macro level incidental management of groundwater economy. By the neighbors who are actually having food, they don't even know how the groundwater economy functions. Yet they are a profound impact on the way the groundwater economy of the other operates.
So you can use that to monitor.
So that just means that I want to give you our experience in on groundwater governance in India. So it's basically the way most Indian states change the policy of pricing electricity for farmers. That basically started creating a bloated artificial groundwater irrigation bubble in India. So in some ways, actually you can say that unsustainable groundwater use in irrigation area today is purely state sanctioned and state supported. If the state wants to prick this bubble, it can prick it overnight. In Gujarat, they will completely abolish subsidies on agricultural use of power. My assessment is that India's annual groundwater use will drop from about 230 cubic BCM to adding 150-160 BCM. Because so much of the groundwater use would not be supported if the cost of producing groundwater was actually charged to the farmers. So fixing the groundwater electricity nexus can, over 5 to 7 year period, resolve 90% of India's groundwater sustainability issue. Shield showed the chart of India, where most of the problems of groundwater overdevelopment are actually concentrated in northwestern and in the southern parts, where the proportion of critical blocks, in overdevelopment groundwater blocks, is very high. In Eastern India, we don't have much of a problem. And the main reason why in Eastern India we don't have much of a problem is because the Eastern India has no power.
Because the economic scarcity is there.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. However, so this is basically how the economy has evolved over there. The number of electric tube wells has kind of increased from less than 150,000-160,000 in around 1970 to about 15-16 million today. The total groundwater withdrawn per year has increased from like 130-135-140 BCM from about 40-50 in 9 years. Agricultural production has also increased. And the power subsidies have contributed, nobody can deny that power subsidies have contributed greatly to 250 million tons of food grain that India produces today. Electricity subsidies have mounted to something, I think the accumulated electricity subsidies today stand at 230,000 crores and the annual subsidy burden is 30,000-40,000 crores. Now the point is that if you just eliminated those elitist subsidies, then I think the total annual groundwater drop could punish him to 60-70% of what it is today. But what will also do is that it will also reduce India's food production by maybe 70-80 million tons in immediate years after that. And the farming sector, of course, would be hit very bad. It's a severe withdrawal syndrome. And it will cause a lot of pain. But over 7 to 8 years, the economy would actually bounce back. If you were to remove power subsidies, it would have an immediate impact of creating pain. But over 5, 6, 7, 8, 10 years, the entire economy, farming system, everything will adjust. And farmers would be then weaned away from the subsidy, and we would have a more efficient groundwater economy. And the agriculture production or agriculture economy would also probably require. But it would take a period of 5, 6, 7, 8, 10 years. The politicians or political leaders are concerned by the immediate political response of a peasantry that is hard hit by the withdrawal of the subsidy. And I think the essential response of politicians is to that. What happens to my votes tomorrow? So the vote bank politics gets involved, and therefore groundwater governance in India has become an intensely political issue. There are so many chief ministers in India who actually lost their seat mostly because they tried to take inconvenient or policy decisions that were inconvenient to farmers. So in that sense, I think groundwater governance needs to be seen in India, needs to be seen in a different light. So subsidy withdrawal syndromes for farmers would be painful, and because of the vote bank politics, no political leader wants to buy the building. So the need in India is for an intermediate solution, and actually a lot of struggle that is taking place in different parts of West India is about what could this intermediate solution be. What kind of an intermediate solution can we find that over medium to long term you can create a more rational textbook kind of a groundwater economy where marginal costs are covered and farmers' behavior is more rational, is rational and so on and so forth. In my estimate, the current regime of farm power subsidy causes a waste of power and groundwater to the extent of about 30-40%. So if, for example, you were to price groundwater and power economic or rational, then both power consumption in groundwater draft as well as agriculture production groundwater use would go down by 30-40%, without significantly affecting agriculture production in the medium to long run. In the immediate run, there would be a problem. There are three ways of doing this, and all the three ways are being attempted in different parts of India. One is providing power subsidy on metered power supply. The problem is not so much the subsidy. The problem is that you are not measuring the power that farmers get and the amount of groundwater that they draft. If you were to, so the current regime of subsidy is that you are actually opening the chest of cash and anybody can come and take whatever they want. So it's actually not a subsidy. Subsidy is something you decide okay, on you will consume a certain volume and on this 20% is a subsidy. But that's not the regime that we have in India today. You give farmers 18 hours of power and even if you keep operating the pumps for 18 hours, there is no one to know that. So the issue is of capping the subsidy. One way to do that is by providing subsidy on heater power supply. Heater are the tubers. And then the others are paying tribute this by minute, but because you are a farmer, we'll charge you 1 rupee. If you are able to do that, that itself will bring a certain amount of rationality in the way groundwater economy functions. The second is by paying farmers, by bribing farmers to curtail the waste. If you meter power, and if you give farmer an entitlement, then okay, if you have 1 hectare of land, then you are entitled to 2,000 units of power a year. And if you don't use your 2,000 units, if you use only 1,500 units, then the state will pay you for the 500 units of power and the groundwater that you have not used. That is another way of incentivizing. The third is just by rationing the power. Now, the first two aren't working because of an irrational and a very strident opposition from farmers. This is the fact of it. And that is because of the experience of the feeling that is shared by a large number of farmers. And this is something that we found in the project that we recently completed for the World Bank. most farmers suspect that the moment they took on the meter charge, right, then in 6 months the government would charge an energy tax, after 6 months, another 6 months they put some other duty, so eventually we end up paying. Flat tariff providing transparency. If you have a 5 horsepower pump, you pay 150 rupees per month per horsepower, so you pay, so there is a certainty about the amount of money that you have to pay to the electricity board. Various experiments are going on. But the important thing to note is that the groundwater players in India are nowhere in the picture in all these experiments. The city deputy does not even probably know that the groundwater use or the groundwater economy of West Bengal or Gujarat are actually affected by the way the state electricity utilities are deciding on. So West Bengal, Kerala, Uttarakhand, what they have done is that they have metered all the tributaries. And West Bengal has installed a very sophisticated system, a high-tech system of metering tube wells, which is a temper loop, to the extent of things, same with temper loop in rural India. But there is remote reading of meters and so on and so forth. And then they've done a smart thing in the sense they've done a theory meter, a theory passing of power. So during the day when all other sectors of the economy need power, there is peak time. The price is set at a very high level, but in the night time, when nobody else wants to use power, farmers can use power at one third the cost. I think this is the closest that we can get to, you know, making our groundwater economy rational. In case of West Bengal, which is actually floating on virtually inexhaustible supply of groundwater, there is a strong case for helping farmers to use more groundwater to improve their livelihoods and so on and so forth. This kind of regimes are needed much more in Rajasthan and India, you know, where almost all agriculture depends on overdevelopment of groundwater. But still, West Bengal offers that experience of what happens when you actually need it. So, the West Bengal model in some ways is the terminal position that most states would like to kind of move in the medium to long term. But politically this has become doable in these states only because the electricity users or farmers who have electric pumps, they're just a small fraction of the total groundwater users. In West Bengal there is 1.1 million shallow tube wells, of which just around 100,000 electric tube wells. So these aren't large, it's not a large enough group to become politically powerful as a vote bank. But in Gujarat also we have 1.1, 1.2 million tube wells, but 900,000 of these are electric tube owners, and half of these have electric pumps larger than 20 horsepower. So if they were metered and if they had to pay normal electricity rates, say one third of what I pay, then they would go out of business. So in Gujarat, for example, if you remove power subsidies on agriculture, I think out of 10 million hectares of land, out of 4.5 million hectares which are under irrigation, at least 2 million hectares would go out of irrigated agriculture. In the medium to long term, they might come back, but at least in the immediate impact would be to decommission a significant chunk of the agriculture. This is what West Bengal is like. In most Western states, starting from Punjab, Haryana, Western UP, Rajasthan, Gujarat, Maharashtra, Andhra Pradesh, and Tamil Nadu, agriculture depends critically on power subsidies. Now here the political opposition to metering is so silent that no political leader, no chief minister would even think about doing it in the near term. So here the experiments are basically about macro management solutions, about switch off solutions to groundwater governance. And in doing that well, it has become very critical to understand the demand for groundwater. Actually, we would have expected that any type of groundwater governance is of no use unless you understand pretty well the demand for groundwater. But there is very little understanding of that. But if you take, say, a state like Madhya Pradesh or Gujarat, then the farmer's demand for groundwater is highly seasonal. There are 3 months in a year, but there are 495 or 100 days in the entire year, in which in Madhya Pradesh, every farmer would want to farm, because everybody wants to grow wheat. In monsoon, they all grow soya, having winter, we want to grow wheat. In summer, we take holiday from farming. There are small garden plots for local vegetables, mostly for growing country, but also some for the market. So the irrigation demand and therefore the power demand peaks during this winter three month period. But because every farmer wants to use his pump, there is total anarchy in the field. There is hooking, if the government does not give a legal connection, I won't take power anyway. So I just hook. And therefore the local grids are in a perpetual state of anarchy with very low voltages and, you know, power outages, very frequent power outages. So it's kind of common property management in the rivers. Then all the farmers in their individual interests, they try and acquire power, but in the process destroy the working of the grid with everybody suffering as a result. And the biggest victim of this is the rural farm sector. The households, the schools, the primary health centers, the cooperatives, institutions, shops, all of them have to suffer this very poor quality of power supply during the peak agriculture. This also, and then most legacy boards try to ration power. But what they do is that they keep three-phase power for say 6 or 7 or 8 or 10 hours. And during the remainder of the year, they have two-phase or single-phase power so that homes can shut. But farmers still keep using power. Pumps would normally not operate until it's a single-phase power. But Indian farmers use a contraption called phase splitter, which can help them to operate even 5, 7, 8, 10 horsepower motors on single-phase power. But when they do that, 10, 15 other users downstream be get hit by those cleaners. So there is a lot of wasted power in monsoon, there is a lot of wasted power in summer, and in winter, there is just not enough power. And that is because the farm power supply, or whoever decides in the farm power supply, has no understanding, or he doesn't even look at the demand pattern. So there is a feeder anarchy during the winter. Frustrated farmer, frustrated village, school children, everybody takes it north. Madhya Pradesh government over the past, actually 5 years ago, Madhya Pradesh enacted a law, public service law, under which you can go and ask for public service, and within a certain specified period of time, the public agency has to respond. To respond, some farmers went and applied for wheat season correction, power connection. And the response had to respond. So they started giving connections. They couldn't give them permanent connections. So they started giving them temporary connections. And as this began, it suddenly became a problem. And in 2011, Madhya Pradesh discoms issued 1 million, I think 980,000 temporary one single season connection. Farmers are excited because they get power when they want. And farmers are paying full commercial rate on a meter carry for this temporary connection. So it's not that there is no subsidy. Actually, the discoms are charging all this money in advance. So the discoms are happy, the farmers are happy. You also reduce the potential for anarchy because farmers who need power, they don't now have to hook. They are allowed to rent transformers, bigger capacity transformers at the village. So this is one response. Now here, the electricity board is struggling with a bunch of farmers, trying to meet the demand of a bunch of farmers. But it actually has major groundwater demand management impact. Gujarat has responded to the same problem five, 7, 8 years ago when the present chief minister came to power. He decided that he was going to win his next election by providing 24/7 top quality power supply to villages. And what he had in mind was not farmers. He actually probably didn't think about farmers. He wanted to provide 24/7 good quality power supply to homes, so that women can watch TV. He wanted to supply power to schools and primary centers. That was his election strategy, and he won. He won the 2000 election because he provided 24/7 power supply. But he couldn't have done this without finding a figuring out a way to make sure that farmers don't keep running their pumps 24 hours, because that would have been clearly disastrous for both the electricity board as well as for the groundwater board. So therefore, Gujarat Electricity Board rewired the entire countryside, all the 18,000 villages were rewired, with a feeder connecting all the tube wells and another feeder connecting all the non farm consumers. In order to get farmers to help this bitter thing, much attention was paid to improving the quality of power supply. So after this scheme of Jyotirgram was implemented, farmers now got 8 hours of seven, maybe they promise 8, but they get about 7 hours of pasture, that's without any interruption, at full voltage. And the rest of the village society, they get 24/7 pasture. We've already done studies and there are strong indications that it's a win-win solution because farmers are very happy. They get fewer hours, but they get very good quality power supply, and the villages are also very happy. This has been a significant groundwater intervention, although it was not intended to be a groundwater intervention, because it created, Jyotirgram created a switch-on, switch-off groundwater economy. In 2009, when there was a drought, when early monsoon was delayed, then the government just increased the hours of power supply to 13 from 7. Allowing the farmers to just pump up more groundwater so that sowing operations could be completed. So I think this has created, this has provided, created a kind of lever to manage the groundwater economy at the macro level. You don't have to go and work with every farmer, giving lectures about sustainability and environment and so on and so forth. You basically have a design system which you can. There are ways to refine this because Gujarat's present system for rationing power supply takes no notice of the pattern of demand. So we asked 500 farmers around Gujarat, who do you need power more? And these are the patterns. If there is a good monsoon, they need only 3 or 4 hours of power during monsoon, but they need a lot during Rabi, and again they don't need much during summer. But if there is a bad monsoon, then everybody wants to irrigate and therefore demand for power during monsoon goes up. So instead of giving flat 8 hours per day throughout the year, if you were to adopt a pattern of power supply, this kind of tries to mimic the power demand, then you would leave and you would have happier peasantry, you would also probably whittle down the aggregate power subsidy and power supply that you are offering the farms. Because of this, as well as because of a mass-based groundwater recharge movement in some parts of Gujarat, but I
said that. I was told because of you this room is very crowded, so I said I would join the crowd.
Yeah, I repeat the whole present. So I think Gujarat is one state, actually the only state in India where groundwater situation is actually looking up. It's a state in which it was a basket case. I mean, parts of Gujarat where you know, world renowned as basket case for groundwater overdevelopment, not Gujarat especially, where farmers need 150 horsepower pumps to pump groundwater to irrigate 10 hectares of land. So in many parts of Gujarat, we find that in the past 10, 12 years, already many of the red spots are turning blue, especially Saurashtra, where there has been this massive groundwater recharge, which is began more or less entirely spontaneously. But I think the state in Gujarat provided very intelligent support to this this community-based groundwater recharge movement. So I think that in India, the groundwater governance is taking place by decision makers totally out of the groundwater economy and who don't even understand fully the impact that they are having on this important economy. And they are trying to find a compromise between a variety of objectives that they have. So they want to, all of them want to reduce the what I'm talking about are the electricity utilities. They are all concerned about very high technical and commercial laws that need to be power tech, cooking and power tech. So they want to control those. Then they want groundwater sustainability dividend is there, but in their minds it's just a marginal kind of a factor. Agriculture growth dividend is very important for political leaders because they know, for example, the reason why Madhya Pradesh has been issuing a million temporary connections with vehicles in the connection is because the chief minister wants to establish a record that his state agriculture is going faster than in Gujarat. Rural quality of life is becoming a very important electoral issue. In fact, in the electoral slogan these days are Bijli Kapra Makan, Bijli Roti Pani, electricity, bread, roti, there is food and water. These are the three things that rural people, who were populated is working. So that has become very important. And Jyotirgram, as I mentioned to you, was basically directed towards winning that part of it. And rural economic research has been. Now that Gujarat has demonstrated that improving the quality of power supply abilities has not only improved the welfare of the people and controls power subsidies, but actually gives a shot in the arm to the rural economy. You know, the diamond merchants or diamond polishing industry is now gradually shifting in geographical villages just because there is as good power supply in a village as you are in Gandhinagar, which is a state capital. So it is these factors which seem to be affecting the way the groundwater economy functions in India today more than what is groundwater. Actually, all the central policies, many of the state governments are in a constant battle with the central agencies like CJWB. CJWB has notified many areas of North Gujarat overdeveloped or critical areas. And every chief minister wants to issue 100,000 more electricity connections to farmers with the elections. In Gujarat, the same thing happened. Modi announced last year that he will issue 100,000 new connections. And they keep having fights with the CGWP. Finally, CGWP has to, give in. So the game of water governance is essentially focused at the state level. The central agencies are increasingly marginalized. The laws that get made at the central level are kind of hardly any effectiveness. And the game is basically played at the state level. And what seems to move the economy is not the things done in the groundwater sector, but outside the groundwater sector. Yeah. So political liberalism is a key driver.
Thank you.